As always, we say peace and blessings by the grace and mercy of the ancient immortality creator, Ancient of Days of Daniels, chapter 7 and 9. And we shall continue, okay, with this subject matter pertaining to the black atheists. And this will be part two. And I dedicate this sermon to my brother Mashiach and all the brothers and sisters that have just resurrected. And pretty much, we are fulfilling 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter and the 13th verse, which speaks about evil men and seducers, how they shall continue to wax worse, deceiving and being deceived, and how they shall continue with these doctrines of demons, which 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1 and 2 explains the situation of the matter. And every day that the sun shines, what they're doing, they're making up a brand new lie to discredit and undermine the scrolls. So now you got this thing called Pangea. Next week, you're going to have something called Pansea. Next week, it's going to be Panzea. Next week, it's going to be Shakawakalia. I mean, the simplicity just doesn't stop. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 15. A fool is right in his own eyes. And they're going to continue with this foolishness until it's all over. So basically, this is what we're dealing with. You have a bunch of stiff-necked people who have not been reading for over 50 years that go on the internet seeking and searching for a brand new lie. Yes, a brand new syphilis gonorrhea lie. And they pretty much wait until you post up certain information, okay, whether on Facebook or YouTube, so they can post their syphilis gonorrhea, okay, satanic buffoonery lie, okay, against the scriptures or any artifact relic of ancient biblical times, which will give us confirmation that this is no mythology. Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 27, it speaks about their characteristics, which are rebellious and stiff-necked. And concerning this atheist thing, this is nothing but recycled Nimrodism. Now, when you look up the Hebrew term Nimrod, it means to rebel against the Creator. Yes, the term Nimrod means to rebel, because Nimrod was an evil, rebellious demon against the Creator. He was the ancient satanic, wicked, demonic king, which they're trying to transform Nimrod into an angel here today. And this is all the atheists are pretty much following. They're following Nimrodism. And it's all being masqueraded under the title of atheist and many other titles. Now, it was Nimrod who excited them, the other people, when he was a king in ancient times, to such an affront. What does it mean he excited them to an affront? He brainwashed the people in ancient times to rebel, to insult, to oppose, to disrespect the supreme same creator that Harriet Tubman spoke about with high respect, Marcus Garvey, Malcolm X, Sojourner Truth, and contempt of the Almighty. What does it mean he taught the people to contempt the Almighty? He taught the people, okay, to scorn, to reapproach, to speak against the creator, to rebel, to disrespect. And this is what they're running with. The so-called black atheists. It's nothing but a transcript ripped out of the concept of ancient evil Babylon. This so-called black atheist operation is nothing but a carbon copycat version of the mindset of the evil Samaritan kingdoms. There's nothing new under the sun. As well as the fake teachings of Christianity is false. Religion is false. Judaism is false. All this is falsehood. All this is evil. It's nothing but an ancient Samaritan Anunnaki, okay, evil doctrine disguised under the term black atheist. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 15. And that which has been is now. They did this same old wickedness over 4,000 years ago in B.C. times, in ancient Babylon, in the Samaritan kingdom. And during the time of the pre-Adamite stage of history. Ecclesiasticus chapter 3, verse 15. And that which has been is now. History is just repeating itself. And that which is to be have already been done. Now it was Nimrod who excited them to affront, to oppose, to disrespect, to say that the Creator does not exist, and to contempt, to insult, to disrespect, to oppose, and to teach as many people as possible this serpent, vampire, evil doctrine of demonic demonology. As 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 13 explains, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. The Assyrian Empire, they recycled this same old madness inside their empire during the time of their rulership. And they're pretty much following the same footsteps of Nimrod. And now the multitude were very ready to follow the determination of Nimrod. Now the multitude were very ready to follow the determination of Nimrod, which is called atheism today. Okay. The Egyptians ran with this same doctrine. The Greek Empire, they ran with this same doctrine. So to the true seekers of the light, don't let them deceive you. This is the time of great deception. It's only a small remnant. That's why these demon liars, they're saying, or have said, that Adam, Eve, Abel, Seth, Enos, Methuselah, Jared, who is the father of Enoch, okay, which is seven generations after Adam. That's why they're saying Enoch never existed. Because Enoch, okay, Jared, Methuselah, okay, Enos, Seth, and Abel, okay, they predate before the Egyptians' dynasty even came into existence. So therefore, the liar has to cook up this serpent lie and say that Abel, Seth, Enos, Enoch, they didn't exist because we said so. Adam and Eve never existed for the simple fact their bloodline pre-existed way before the first Egyptian dynasty even rose. And this so-called atheist serpent vampire deception ain't no different than the 1492 okay, deception of the Renaissance, just like these false images here that we're viewing here today. Okay, their doctrine ain't no different than these falsehood images of Adam and Eve, which, for the record of understanding, Adam and Eve's name has been found carved on those ancient biblical Elba tablets, as well as the Babylonian tablets that they found in northern Mesopotamia. They found the name Isaac and Jacob, okay, carved on those tablets as well. But what this is really about, this is about leading as many people as possible astray to worship the demon world and to set them up for a horrific judgment, which many people think is a joke. People think they're going to do what they want to do on this earth and that there's not going to be no consequences. Now let's go to our first candidate, who goes by the name of Sheba, and she explains, okay, how she was born, if I'm not mistaken, in South Carolina, and she went to church like most of us went to church, and, you know, and also she has some experience with the Old Testament Israelites, who told her that she couldn't watch TV, and also that she could not read the New Testament, and how she studied herself right outside what is known today as the Bible, and how she also came to this Maxwell Jordan Zeiss guy, Helena Blavatsky, okay, same conclusion, that the intelligence in the scriptures is plagiarized. That's the new demonic term to be used. Something to be plagiarized means to be the same exact as. So she states the information is plagiarized after the belief system of the Babylonians, the Samaritans, and the Egyptians' concept But when you go and examine page 267 from the Book of the Dead, which they also classify as the coming of the book by day, it speaks about these two gods, one by the name of Hu and the other by the name of Sa. And it explains how Hu and Sa are said to have come into being existence from the drops of blood which fell from Ra, which Ra is supposed to be the god that created all existence. So it explains on page 267, the god Hu and Sa, okay, came into being existence. They came into existence from the drops of blood which fell from Ra when he cut off his phallus. So when Ra castrated his own private organs, and from the blood that was dripping from his own castrated organs, the god Hu and Sa was brought into existence. In the 1611 King James, it's supposed to be plagiarized after what we just read. So what verse and chapter can I find this same exact recording in the King James? Or maybe we can find it in the Scrolls of Jubilee, which was recorded in B.C. biblical time, which they found some of these scrolls in Qumran in K4. Or maybe we can find it in the Scrolls of Jasher, which was recorded in B.C. biblical time, which they found some of the Scrolls of Jasher in K4 in Qumran. Or maybe we can find it in the Ancient Testaments of Solomon, which speaks about how the evil demonic forces are using many men, woman, and child to bring forth deception and evil. Or maybe we can find it in the Scrolls of Baruch that was recorded in ancient biblical times, which they're trying to make it seem like it was something that came about just recently. Or maybe we can find it in the ancient scrolls of Esdras, which goes back to the time of Nebuchadnezzar's rulership. And also, we should be able to find, okay, some passages or scriptures that supports the Samaritan Anunnaki demon god that's half man and half beast. The book of Proverbs, chapter 12, verse 20. Deceit is in the heart of them that imagine evil. And that's all this plagiarization game is dealing with. Deceit, lies, demonology, witchcraft, 666, evil. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 19. The lips of truth shall be established forever, but a lying tongue is but for a moment. It's dealing with nothing but lies, deception, and demon worship. So let's go to the sister Sheba, who has been brainwashed with this tactic of deception, to believe that the intelligence in the scriptures and the other scrolls, which there are many, and tablets, is nothing but, okay, bits and pieces and crumbs that have been extracted, okay, from the Babylonian, the Samaritan kingdom, the Egyptian dynasty, okay, so on and so forth. And that is plagiarize, plagiarize, plagiarize.
I want to ask Sheba, because I know you and your husband, y'all used to be part of the Hebrew Israelites. And
right.
And from what I understand, and I hear this from a lot of people, that you guys studied yourself up out of the Bible.
That's right.
Break that down.
Well, I guess just to give you a little bit of background about me.
Okay.
I grew up here in the South, in the Bible Belt. Grew up in the church. I grew up in a Pentecostal Holiness church. And I guess for most of my life, even while I was in the church, I questioned most of the stuff that I was being taught. That you would have people that say, you know, you can't lean to your own understanding.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, don't question God. It's wrong for you to question God. Or, mm-hmm. you know, don't trust anything that you're basically thinking.
Right.
Pretty much, right? Pretty much. So,
because your heart is wicked, right?
Right.
Right.
I was born and it was wicked.
Yeah.
But I just started studying a little more. You know, the older I got, and when those questions couldn't be answered, I kind of just put that down. I started thinking about Islam some.
Okay.
Being on the whole Malcolm X thing and listening to a lot of, you know, black folks like Assalamu alaikum and all of that.
Right.
I thought that was us for a long time, that was our saying until I realized that it was part of the religion.
We got a lot of people who still think that's us.
Right. Yeah. So after that, I was sitting looking at a show kind of like this right here. And it was still talking about the Bible, but it started putting black people, putting black faces on it. And because I always felt like we didn't really have a culture, that spoke to me. Mm-hmm. But the more I got into that, I was like, okay, this is a lot like Christianity. But I was still really serious about wanting to be a good Hebrew Israelite. So the New Testament, of course, had been put down. And we were just studying out of the Old Testament.
Okay.
So that meant we had to keep the Saturdays, going back to what you said. So keeping Saturdays and studying on Saturdays,
mm-hmm.
no TV and all that kind of stuff, studied myself right out of the book.
Congratulations to you.
Congratulations. Yeah, because I just saw how much plagiarism was in it. You know, all of it comes from another group, another culture, and splices from this cult or, you know, this faith all down through time. And we just have the little scraps from it, and we eat off of it.
So there you have it. Just like it states in Revelation 12 and 9, which speaks about the serpent, the dragon, how this entity will deceive the whole world. Now I'm going to move on to the next point. But this plagiarization, that term, they took that term right off of that Zeitgeist DVD. Which this term was used way before Zeitgeist even came out of their mother's womb. But just to make a point, let's go to that statement from that Zeitgeist DVD, who uses that sorcery plagiarization term. And then let's go back to Sheba, where she uses that plagiarization term. And this plagiarization term did not become popular among our people until their mind got zapped and twist-twangled and shangle-bangle by that Zeitgeist DVD.
Furthermore, the character of Jesus being a literary and astrological hybrid is most explicitly a plagiarization of the Egyptian sun god Horus.
Yeah, because I just saw how much plagiarism was in it. You know, all of it comes from another group.
So there you have it, Matthew 18:23. For by sorcery were all the nations deceived. This is straight up sorcery. And the majority of the people is going to follow this sorcery all the way to the end. Because it's only a remnant. For it has been written. And we understand why people reject Christianity and religion and Judaism and the false teachings, okay, that's in Christianity. Which is nothing but Babylonian teachings all mixed in with a ball of confusion. Now let's go to this next clipping, okay, from Sheba. When she makes these vain statements, because this is not statements based upon historical research, it's all emotions. When she spoke about us congregating in slavery pertaining to our ancestors and how they were reading from a book that puts them down, and pretty much how this came from the slave masters, pretty much this is what they're trying to say. And then at the end of her statement, she says she don't know because she doesn't really know.
But I think you were saying, why are we so religious, or why black folks are just, you know, say religion? Because you got to go back to slavery, because that's where only place that we were able to congregate and sing back in the day. You was able to be in a church and read from the Bible that's putting you down. You know,
right.
But that's the only thing that you were able to read, or were you even able to read it, or they taught it to you? I don't know what was going on. Were you even able to read it, or they taught it to you? I don't know what was going on.
Now let's go back in the time before the Atlantic slave trade even came into existence, when our ancestors was dwelling on the west coast of so-called Africa. This information is recorded in a book called The Hebrew Heritage of Black Africa by Moses Farah. And it states this, a man by the name of Dr. Krippel, in his book, about the Jews and Judaism. Well, first of all, there's no such thing as Jew or Judaism. Just like there's no such thing as Christianity or religion. These terms were created to create a whole bunch of confusion and deception and to deceive. Under these terms, Judaism, Jew, Christianity, and religion, there's no such thing. Dr. J. Krippel, in his book about the Hebrews, also he reports a large Hebrew community in the interior of Dahomey, which was once on the west coast of Africa, where our past ancestors once dwelled before the triangle slave trade even came into existence. They were living in this community on the west coast interior, known as Dahomey. Dr. K. Rappel, he continues stating, he says, our ancestors in this community, they have a central temple and a Torah written in Hebrew letters when it was dwelling on the west coast of Africa in the interiors of Dahomey. In a community way before the slave master came, they used to read out of the Torah written in Hebrew. And they did not learn this from the slave master because the triangle slave trade and the slave master have not yet even came down to the west coast of Africa. Now let's go to this next clipping and let's examine this statement by this individual by the name of Black Sun and how he states how he do not see the scriptures as a credible source and how it was written by man. Well, there were certain men that recorded the Samaritan history on cuneiform tablets. There were certain different men, okay, in the Babylonian Empire that recorded their history, okay, on cuneiform tablets. Just because a man writes something in ancient biblical time doesn't mean it doesn't have validation. Especially when you're dealing with visionaries from ancient times who have made many predictions over 5,000-6,000 years ago that is being manifested in our lifetime in the 21st century, just like the ancient scrolls of Ezra that goes back to B.C., Babylonian, Nebuchadnezzar's rulership, which Ezra spoke about how iniquity would increase, meaning we would come into a time when evil would climax to its highest degree and how the land would be barren of faith concerning believing into the immortality creator. And as Isaiah chapter 60 verse 1 explains how gross darkness would engulf this earth. And that's exactly where we are at right now today. Just like 2 Ezra chapter 5 verse 9 explains how many of your friends shall transform to be your enemy. And this was written in BC times. And it is happening. And it is escalating. But let's go to this individual statement pertaining to how he claims that he doesn't see the intelligence in the scriptures as a credible source.
The Bible itself is speaking of technology, man. That was another thing that struck me. Like,
about the Bible, I don't find it to be a credible source, and neither do I find the Quran. You know what I'm saying? Just like how you said, you just came up with this thesis about, you know, the spaceships. I mean, just like your person, the person who wrote, or the 300 people who wrote that book were people, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I don't want, when people try to use the Bible or use the Quran as a credible source, I'm like, yo, it was made by man, and who?
The Bible itself is speaking of technology, man. That was another thing that struck me. Like,
about the Bible, I don't find it to be a credible source, and neither do I find the Quran. You know what I'm saying? Just like how you said, you just came up with this thesis about, you know, the spaceships. I mean, just like your person, the person who wrote, or the 300 people who wrote that book were people, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I don't want, when people try to use the Bible or use the Quran as a credible source, I'm like, yo, it was made by man.
Now I want to clear something up, okay, with this picture here pertaining to slavery and this fake thing called religion. All that has been done is the so-called slave master, he took the information which we already had and he forced a falsehood interpretation inside the mind of our ancestors, okay, by force until we were so brainwashed they no longer needed to use force anymore. And that's pretty much what really happened. Because when you check out the customs of the Ashantis, brothers on the west coast of Africa, they had what is known today, the Torah, way before the slave master came. And they were following the principles of Leviticus. And our past Ashanti ancestors, the men, some of them used to wear a breastplate that had 12 stones on the breastplate, which signified the 12 sons of Yaqob. Now, this is deeper than just saying you're Hebrew, because that don't mean nothing if you're wicked as hell. And also, they was following the codes and the rules that's recorded in what is known today as Deuteronomy and Leviticus. Now, here's an example of what really happened. This was taken from what they call the Haley's Bible Handbook. The word Bible is deception. No such thing as Bible. That was made up also to confuse people, which comes from the word Biblios, as many of you already know. You're talking about information that has been translated from another tongue and compiled in a book form and falsely stamped with this term Bible, Apocrypha, and Pseudepigrapha. This is all falsehood. But pertaining to the situation of the matter, this is really what took place and happened on the west coast of Africa, so-called Africa, when the slave master came. As black Africans, you see, the term Africa is another term of deception. There's no such people as Africans. That's a Roman general name, Leo Scipios Africanus. And the term black, there's no such people as black. You would not find a nation in ancient time known as black. That's another term of trickery used to confuse. As black Africans were forcibly, this is talking about our ancestors, they were brought to the States, the United States, and they were sold as slaves on the auction blocks on Wall Street. And there was not one true descendant of the Egyptian Kemet bloodline being sold on the auction blocks on Wall Street either. It is surprising that they would have anything to do with their oppressor's religion. Well, of course, they've been brainwashed. That's why they're dealing with this nonsense. They was brainwashed by force with falsehood interpretation. Take this word religion and throw it in the garbage can. The real issue of the matter is that the slave master, he came with falsehood interpretation. Religion is just a term used to confuse people, which comes from the Latin word religio. But upon their arrival, the slaves, our ancestors, they were immediately taught, brainwashed, into Christianity, which there's no such thing in the intelligence, and the scrolls is not talking about no Christianity, which comes from the Greek word Christos, which is another term used to confuse the hell out of people pertaining to what this is really talking about. It's not talking about no stupid Christo term, which is just a false label, title term. So it says they were immediately taught Christianity. Let me put it in its proper perspective. They were immediately brainwashed by force, especially with falsehood interpretation and repeatedly with Paul's exhortation, which states, slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear. Ephesians 6, verse 5. So the slave master, he took Ephesians chapter 6, verse 5 letters, and he created his own falsehood, witchcraft, warlock interpretation. And he falsely claimed that Ephesians 6 and 5, when it speaks about slaves, obey your earthly masters, he falsely claimed that this was talking about him, which was a damn lie. And how you know this is a damn lie? Because when the epistle letter of Paul of Ephesians chapter 6, verse 5 was written, we ain't even yet coming to the 14, the 15, the 1300s, and the 1600 yet. It was written around the time period of 64 AD during the earlier stage of the Roman Empire. Thomas Jefferson, Andrew Jackson, Abraham Lincoln ain't even yet came out of their mother's womb when Ephesians chapter 6 verse 5 was written. So this was falsehood, witchcraft, wickedness, which the slave master falsely claimed this was referring to him. When the timetable period is totally out of sync with what they were proclaiming. This is dealing with around 64 AD. The Atlantic slave trade ain't even come into existence yet. Isabella Hernan Cortez, Francisco Pizarro ain't even come into existence yet. Christopher Columbus ain't even come into existence yet. George Washington ain't even come out of his mother's womb yet.
So the slave master
He forced this falsehood interpretation inside the mind of our ancestors with the cracking of the whip. Pertaining to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 5, when it stated, obey your masters, it was not talking about no slave masters. It was really referring to elder shepherds who were guiding brothers and sisters in the right order structure of the Creator's understanding and how to deal with each other correctly and properly. I want to go back to Black Sun's statement one more time when he states he don't see the intelligence in the scrolls, which they falsely call Bible, as a creditable source in how it was written by man. Which man we know on earth did not write these books? The men of ancient Babylon recorded their history on what is known as cuneiform tablets. The ancient men of the Samaritan kingdom recorded their history on cuneiform tablets. The ancient Egyptian scribes recorded many things on papyrus scrolls. So this is just a lame duck excuse to reject scripture. But let's go to his statement one more time for confirmation, how he stated that the intelligence in the manuscripts is not of creditable source.
I don't find it to be a credible source, and neither do I find the Quran. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I don't. When people try to use the Bible or use the Quran as a credible source, I'm like, yo, it was made by man, and who?
So there you have it. This is what you call deception. And also, Black Sun, he makes a statement pertaining to how, who they call Jesus Christ, how he had a private prayer room, and he asked a question. Who was there to record that?
Like, I think Keisha had mentioned, like, you know, Jesus had a private prayer. Well, who was there to, you know what I'm saying, write that down?
Well, what many people don't understand is that the true King of Victory, he told the 12 disciples many things in secret that he did not tell the regular population. As the book of Matthew's, okay, chapter 13 and verse 10 and 11 explains. As the book of Matthew's, chapter 11, verse 25 explains. Now, concerning his statement, one more time for the record of understanding, how he claimed that the intelligence in the scriptures is not of creditable source. Well, let's examine this clipping that we're looking at right now from the movie called The Django, which pretty much shows us and gives us a perfect example of how our past ancestors was forced to pick cotton inside the cotton field. And when we turn to the scrolls of Deuteronomy, chapter 28 and verse 16, which was written in ancient biblical times. It was not written during the time of the Greek or the Roman Empire. It was written way before the Greek and the Roman Empire even came into existence, which speaks about those cotton fields that our past ancestors was subjected to pick cotton, which was predicted because of their evil sins, which many don't want to accept. The fact of the matter that it is something that we have done that has caused all this hell to come upon our head. Deuteronomy chapter 28, 16. Cursed shall thou be in the city, and cursed shall thou be in the field, in the cotton field. Cursed shall thou be in the cotton field. As Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 16 predicted in ancient times. As this movie clipping from this movie Django is demonstrating to us, which was written in ancient B.C. biblical time. Now, the serpent of deception will falsely claim that this was written by the Greeks and the Romans. You see, that's the way the serpent is coming. They will not explain the situation of the matter correctly. They will explain the situation of the matter accordingly to the profile that's recorded in the book of Proverbs chapter 12, verse 20. Deceit is in the heart of them that imagine, okay, evil. So let's go to this next clipping from this movie called The Django. And let's examine, okay, for confirmation of understanding, to prove that these statements are false. pertaining to the statement of Black Sun, when he claimed that the intelligence in the scriptures is not of a credible source. Now let's examine another clipping from this movie called Django, which gives us a perfect example of some of the things that our ancestors went through in hardcore slavery, man, woman, and child. How a yoke of iron, as we examine this clipping from the Django video, how a yoke of iron with four hooks on each side was put upon the necks of our past ancestors, male, female, and child. As we analyze this visual clipping from this movie, The Django, pertaining to what happened to our ancestors in the 1600 hardcore slavery. And then we turn to the scrolls of Deuteronomy, the 28th chapter, verse 47 and 48, and I put emphasis on this. This was written over 3,000 years ago. But Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 47 and 48 confirms and pretty much explains why these yokes of iron was put upon our ancestors' neck. And it predicted this would happen. The 47th verse explains, because thou servest not the Creator, who they falsely call Lord God, which is not the Creator's name. Because thou servest, thou respect not the Creator, with joyfulness and with gladness of heart, for the abundance of all things, because we were not always in this critical position that we are in here today with this poverty and oppression. The 48th verse. Therefore shall thou serve thy enemies, because our ancestors began to disrespect the supreme creator of the universe, the same way the children who are a descendant of that same rebellious generation, okay, are still disrespecting the true authority of our existence, who they falsely call God. The 48th verse. Therefore shall thou serve thy enemy, which we are still doing. That's what these 9-to-5 jobs is about. Which the Creator shall send against thee in hunger. To get food, you got to go to the supermarket, because we no longer own our land anymore. And in thirst, you even got to pay for water. These statements are true. And in nakedness, because we don't control anything. We are subjected, okay, to being controlled. And in the want of all things, even to get married, you got to go to the man. And he shall put a yoke of iron, just like what they are showing us in this video in Django, as we analyze with our eyes right now. And then go back and read Deuteronomy 28, 48. And read when it says, and he shall put, that he is the slave master, he shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck until he have destroyed thee. He shall put a yoke of iron, just like the yoke of irons that we are looking at in this video from the movie Django, that was put upon the necks of the men and women of our nation in hardcore slavery, just like the ancient biblical scroll predicted in biblical time to happen in the 1600s and the 1700s. And he shall, the slave master, shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck until he have destroyed thee. Which did happen in the 15 and the 1600. Is Deuteronomy chapter 28 verse 47 and 48 talking about the word religion? Hell no. Where did the word religion come? It comes from a Latin word religio, which means to bind up. Is Deuteronomy chapter 28 verse 47 and 48 talking about the word religion? No. What is it talking about? History. Was a four-pronged yoke of iron hook put upon our ancestors' neck in the 1600s and the 1500s, just like the ancient scroll, Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 47 and 48, predicted? Yes. What is that? History. Is it valid? Yes. What is this? This is creditable. Why? Because it did happen. What are we talking about? History. Are we talking about some stupid word, religio, which is where the English word come from? Which this term has been created to confuse the hell out of the people and to twist the scriptures upside down and to give people falsehood interpretation and falsified understanding. And also those men and women in those mega churches, they was not sent by the Creator. They were all set up to deceive and to manipulate. and to brainwash the people. At the same time, make money off of ignorant people that refuse to investigate, refuse to read, and refuse to humble themselves, who's blinded by their own pride. Tiberius Caesar was one of the emperors that ruled during over 2,000 years ago. Was he a real person? Yes, he was. His name is recorded in Luke, the third chapter. What is that? History, not mythology. Is it creditable? Yes, it is. Because Tiberius Caesar was a real emperor over 2,000 years ago, whose name is found in Luke, the third chapter. So this is a bunch of nonsense. This is a bunch of recycled Gnostic wickedness. Yes, these are the children of the evil Gnostics, the wicked Gnostics. Yes, they were so-called wicked Negroes in the first and second century. And they went to and fro, making up a whole bunch of syphilis, gonorrhea lies pertaining to this issue of the matter. And when you turn to Genesis chapter 6, verse 4, and when you turn to Numbers chapter 13, verse 33, and when you turn to Joshua chapter 15, verse 8, and when you turn to Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 28, it speaks about the giants, which during many different archaeological excavations, they found the remains of many giants, skeletons, skulls, legs, and bones in Greece, also recorded in what is known as the Hindu Voice paper, in a location called Empty Quarters. A National Geographic team of India Division and the Indian Army, they also found several giant bones, skulls, and arms and legs. And these giants, their height could reach from 15 to 20 feet tall, like the Sumerian ancient giants. And also they found giant footprints in South Africa, going back over 2 million years old. And also they found in so-called Africa, giant footprint marks on different rocks. Now this is what the Gnostics will do. They try to prove that Kemet was first. I mean, this is the game that they play. When there was empires way before Kemet. But the issue of the matter is truth. We don't want to get into that, oh, Kemet and Babylon. And that's just a bunch of sorcery trickery to confuse and to deceive people. Just like the term Africa, just like the term Egypt, just like the term Negro, just like the term religion, just like the term Judaism, just like the term Bible, just like the term Christianity, just like the term Christmas, just like the term Easter, just like the scrolls of Enoch explain how many sinners they were altered. See, they playing three-card Molly with the information and confusing people by labeling everybody under this term Africa. You see, that ain't no different than fake Christianity teachings, because it's not true. Many sinners will alter and misrepresent the truth. They will say evil things. They will tell lies like Abraham never existed, Adam never existed, Enoch never existed, because they said so. Even though Adam, Enoch, Joshua, their names can be found on different cuneiform tablets of the other nations that was recorded in biblical times. Many sinners will alter. That's who these guys are. They're the new 21st century evil Gnostics. This is the same thing that the evil Gnostics used to do. Many sinners will alter and misrepresent the truth. They will say evil things. They will tell lies. And they will make up great falsehood. They will make up great falsehood. And also, they will write books in their own words. And they got a lot of demon books on the market, which is written by Dr. Finkelfoot. Yeah, look who's writing this information. Yes, sometimes they tell the truth. But when it comes to the case of the scriptures, they're a bunch of demonic, satanic liars. So this is who these people really are. That's cloaking himself under the term, okay, atheist.
Boy, boy, boy. I see chariots in the skies. Men on earth look surprised as they flew across the skies. As they flew across the skies.
Coming from the edge of the universe, went past the moon to the earth, then from the womb to the nurse. With a slight remembrance, how I came from a distance to an instant existence with five senses. The quest for man repentance. While others cried, I exercised my third eye by hearing a lullaby. Then I magnified inside, became intelligent and wise. Transformed from the celestial.
As they flew across the skies. As they flew across the skies. As they flew across the skies. As they flew across the skies.
Coming from the edge of the universe, went past the moon to the earth, then from the womb to the nurse. With a slight remembrance, how I came from a distance to an instant existence with five senses. The quest for man repentance. While others cried, I exercised my third eye by hearing a lullaby. Then I magnified inside, became intelligent and wise. Transformed from the celestial, shot through a sexual, terrestrial testicles vessel. Small as a decimal where I nestle. 9 months later, special delivery to killer P-R-I-E. E-S-T. From the fetus to the cleavage, from atoms to atoms, from atoms to atoms, from atoms to atoms.
I see chariots in the skies, men and earth look surprised as they flow across the skies.